Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Good evening, everyone. I'd like to welcome you to the July 17th meeting of the County Commissioners. And before we begin, I'd like to ask Mr. Lashley if he will do our invocation.
Be glad to. Let's bow our heads. Gracious Heavenly Father, we pause at this time to honor you by thanking you for this day and all the many days in our lives. We thank you for this nation. We thank you for our people. We ask you to give us good government, and we ask that same here tonight. In your holy name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, sir, and I guess we don't have any public speakers. Here's the book.
Thank you.
Wayman Armstrong.
My name is Wayman Armstrong. I live in Mebane, North Carolina. Really hoping I wouldn't go first, but here I am. I'm here basically, and I appreciate you, Mr. Boswell, and you, Ms. Gailey, for responding to my emails I sent, because I did send them to everyone. But we've got a bad case of monkey see, monkey do going on in not only this county, but some other counties. It's where people get out, they mow their grass, and they think, let's just throw it into the road. Well, there's a couple things that happen here. One, it's an eyesore. And I don't think we want eyesores in Alamance County. It's too pretty. But if you ride a motorcycle like I do, or a bicycle, and you pull up to a stop sign, and you go to put your foot down on that grass, it's like putting it on ice. And the way I realized that was at the corner of Dodson and Mebane Rogers Road, where Eastern High School is. They had thrown, which they did again yesterday, and I came to a stop and almost dropped my 1,000-pound motorcycle on myself. A couple things could have happened. It could have been burned, or nobody could have come along for a while. But anyway, I've been trying to research, and the county attorney, I guess, sent me, Mr. Albright, sent me an email saying this was a DOT matter. Well, in a lot of cases, I think there's a situation where there's laws. We just need to get the laws enforced. And if we can get behind everybody, if I stop and tell somebody you can't throw grass in the road, you're going to have to call the law out, because they're not going to like me stopping and telling them what to do, and I shouldn't be doing that. But the littering law is the one that covers this. I have a copy of it here if anybody would like a copy. And there's a section in there where it talks. It doesn't say specifically grass clippings. It's a $200 fine. I'm not wanting to see anybody get a fine, but I say, if you tell them there's a fine, they would probably quit doing it. And what's happening is when people see it, and other people are doing it, getting away with it, it just continues to happen. So that's my big concern, and I think it's a safety issue. It's a matter of time. I can show you pictures on Facebook where other people have had accidents because of things as this case, but it's time for it to get drawn to a nub. This is my fourth year starting in Alamance County. It's getting worse each summer. So that's where I'm at.
All right.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for
very
coming.
Good. Thank you.
Do we have copies of what you were?
Yeah, that'd be good. And I know Mike Mills from DOT is emailing you and I on that. And
he was sending copies to the state attorney general.
Right.
And some others, and I appreciate y'all forwarding that on.
Thank you.
There's a lot to it. I guess it's like a lot of laws. There's a lot of reasons.
Yep. Maybe we can actually get some of our newspapers to help us out with that a tad. All right. We don't have anybody else to speak, so next we have commissioner responses. If anyone has something to say about that.
I just say thank you to Mr. Armstrong for coming out tonight and for bringing the issue to our attention. I really appreciate that.
All right. Next, we need the approval of agenda, but I would like to add one thing that got skipped over last week. Mac Williams is here tonight to bring an incentive company to us for a public hearing. So if we could, I'd like to put him right after our consent agenda.
I'll make that motion.
Thank you, Bill.
Second.
Thank you, Amy. All in favor?
Aye.
All right. Consent agenda, is there anything there that needs to be looked at?
I move we accept the consent agenda.
All righty.
Second.
Thank you, Amy. All in favor?
Aye.
All right, Matt.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Commissioners, I'm Matt Williams. I'm president of the Alamance Chamber, and in that role, I work with industrial prospects that are considering Alamance County. We have that case here. And so I'm coming to you tonight to request that you set a date for a public hearing for incentives for a company called Airgas, A-I-R-G-A-S, Airgas Inc. And would like to request that the date for the public hearing be August the 7th. And all the details about the project will be forthcoming. Certainly we will have a representative of the company here that night to go over all the details and to answer questions of the public and of yourselves.
Is that a night meeting or a day
meeting?
That's
a morning meeting.
Yeah, you said night.
The 7th.
He said the 7th.
August 7th.
That's our morning meeting.
That's a morning meeting?
Yeah. And I would like to inform the chair, I will be able to be here for that. So I'm not asking that you delay anything or postpone it, but I have a class that morning at 8 o'clock. I can't get over here.
Okay.
But you can, well, conduct business.
I'll make the motion we accept that.
I'll second it.
Okay. Thank you, Bill. Thank you, Bob. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Thank you, Mac.
Thank you very much. We'll see you August 7th.
Okay. Very good. All right, next on the agenda, we have the recommendation from the Graham Planning Board that I pulled last month because for some reason I wasn't smart enough to get my applications for two of them. But after reviewing and talking to city council members, they had actually recommended Justin Moody as for their ETJ appointment. And with that, I think Justin and Barry are both here, but my recommendation I would like to make a motion that we appoint Justin as the ETJ person for a ground planning board as they've asked. Any discussion on that or questions?
Well, I'll second the recommendation. I'll second the motion based on the recommendation of the Graham City Council.
Okay. Any questions? Okay.
I'm going to nominate Barry Hikes.
Okay. I guess we need to vote on the motion and second.
Yeah. Okay.
All right. All in favor of Justin Moody to take that appointment? Say so by aye.
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 And looks like we've got four votes on that bill.
Okay.
Anyhow, thank both of you for coming out for that. And also we have the appointment of Justin to the ETJ for the, what's the second one? Board of Adjustments. And I would like to go ahead and make a motion that we follow through with that also.
I had talked to Graham City Council people about this as well, so I'll second the motion.
All right. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Very good, and thank both of you for coming out tonight. Barry, I know you've served there and appreciate that, and I don't know what happened, but we try to kind of work with them and do what we have to.
Okay.
Thank you very much. All right, Recreation and Parks, Brian Baker, if you will come forward, sir.
Brian, how you doing?
Good. Good evening, Commissioners. Have a similar appointment issue for you guys tonight. We have two spots on the Recreation and Parks Commission that need to be filled, and it's unusual for us to get more applicants than we have spots, but in this case we do. We have four applicants and two spots. One of the people seeking the appointment is Lee Isley. He's been on the commission and he's seeking reappointment. And the other three individuals are Mr. Kirk Puckett, Ms. Jocelyn Caleb, and Ms. Penny Hawkins, that are also seeking appointment. The Recreation and Parks Commission has considered all the candidates and is recommending the appointment of Mr. Isley and Kirk Puckett to the open positions.
I'll make that motion.
I'll second it. Are any of them here?
No, I don't see them.
Lee was over at
Lee was at the
other thing, yeah. And Lee's been very active on that committee. I know he's helped us get a sign out here for the Hall River Trail and so forth, and been very good to that. Okay, we have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you, sir. Property and liability insurance renewal.
Good evening, Commissioners. I'm going to ask Rhonda Morkel, finance payroll specialist, to come and present that item for us tonight.
Rhonda, how you doing?
I'm doing well, Mr. Lashley. How are you?
Good.
You know, it's rare that I get up here, right?
That's right.
Special occasion.
Special occasion, that's right. Once a year I come to see you guys. We have with us tonight Alan Crouch from Hub International, who is our broker. He has brought to us a renewal bid of $537,000 for the entire package. That's with a 3.9% increase, which is pretty phenomenal. We're very pleased with that. I mean, it is an increase, of course, but with everything that county employees have to deal with, you know, the Sheriff's Department, EMS, they have a lot of things that go on, and we're pretty pleased with that renewal quote. The increase is due to some additional equipment that we hadn't added. We don't send them an entire list of equipment every year, and this year we did, so they could capture everything, all of our big equipment, like at the landfill. So that made it rise just a little bit, and I think it was back in the fall of last year the sheriff might have gotten four positions, and the law enforcement liability is strictly based on the number.
I thought it was because the sheriff was reckless driving. That's not the right
one. So the law enforcement liability is based strictly on the number of positions they have, so that's why there's a little bit of an increase there. So we're here tonight to ask for your approval to bind that coverage.
I had a couple of questions.
Okay.
What is our budget for this?
It is right at the 537. We're about $9,000 over than what I had projected for the budget, but we have that in fund balance if I remember correctly.
In the property and liability fund itself.
So we're good with that.
All right. And then is there such a thing for an elected body such as ours as having directors and officers insurance, and is that covered in this?
We actually have a coverage. It's called public official liability, or public entity management liability.
That's
is that
correct?
The correct
is that word that is?
That covers all of y'all.
I thought we were probably the excess liability down at the bottom.
Speak for yourself.
No, that public entity is you.
Thank you.
Anything else?
I move approval.
Second.
All right. Thank you, Bob. Thank you, Bill. Any more discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you.
Thank you, Rhonda.
Thank you.
All right. Brian, infrastructure debt payment for the North Carolina Commerce Park.
Yes, sir. Good evening, Mr. Chairman and Commissioners.
I'm before you this evening requesting that you approve us to the county to pay to the cities of Mebane and Graham $272,553.01. Back in May of 2013, Alamance County, Graham, and Mebane joined together to do the North Carolina Commerce Park. This is where we just had the big opening for Prescient. The agreement between the three local governments was that we would all share equally in the development costs of the park, the infrastructure, roads, et cetera. So far, we've had several projects at the North Carolina Commerce Park. This includes Walmart, Prescient, Lidl. So it's been a successful park so far. We're hopeful that it'll continue to draw in new business. Back in when the park was open, Graham and Mebane fronted the county's share of the initial infrastructure costs. The county's share was $2,133,207.11. So Graham and Mebane put that money up front for us. The county agreed to pay its share with our one-third share of the Walmart tax revenue. So we didn't put any money up front. We said we would give our third of the property tax revenue from the Walmart project to each of the cities to pay off our debt. We paid the cities of Mebane and Graham $105,110.32 toward this debt last fiscal year. Our current amount that we owe Graham and Mebane is $2,028,096.79. That's our current amount that we owe. So the city of Graham, during the infrastructure development and construction, they applied for a Golden Leaf reimbursement grant to help offset those initial road costs. The grant was awarded this past June, and we got our share, which was this $272,553.01. So we have our share back that we put in originally, and what I'm recommending, this is grant money that came to the county to help us offset our original cost of development. I'm recommending that we give the two cities our share of this grant funding. We give it back to them. That would bring our debt with the two cities down to $1,755,543.78. So this is not general fund money. This is money that has come back to us from a grant that we were fortunate enough to get reimbursed. And what it will do is knock down the amounts we owe the two cities and hopefully make it quicker that we'll be able to keep the Walmart tax revenue. So I'm happy to try to answer any questions, but I think that this would be a wise use of the money. Go ahead and start paying down as much as we can some of this debt for infrastructure costs. So.
I agree with you. I'll make the motion.
A second.
Okay.
Thank you. I just have one question. What is the value of one-third of the tax revenue from Walmart?
I think, let's see. I don't know if Susan Mike can help me answer that. We paid Mebane and Graham $105,110 for 16-17. So
it'd be roughly $300,000 total that we're getting?
I'm not sure that's exactly right. I would have to look into that and tell you, but I know that's the total amount that we paid them last year.
And the length of this loan, the time to pay back was how long from the original agreement?
Until it's paid off.
Until it's paid off.
Yes, there's no interest, and it's a no-interest loan, and it's until the debt is paid.
Okay, so I mean, this makes a lot of sense.
Yeah.
And I can get you all the dollar figures that we have paid them so far and what that revenue is, but I don't have that.
Any other questions? Got a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Thank you, sir. Next, we'll look at infrastructure, our county facility plan.
All right. So, as you well know, we've been talking about putting together some kind of a plan for county government to start looking at our buildings. We've been talking about it for a couple of years, about a need to do so. I'm going to go over a little bit of general information about county buildings and kind of tell you where we are. And then I've got some recommendations for you to consider tonight that are pretty initial, early on actions that I think make sense for us to do, even at this point in our facility planning process. So, you need to know we've got 40 buildings, total of over 500,000 square feet. Average age of our building is 44 years. We have some that are fairly new, and we have some very old buildings too, but they average 44 years old. Of our 40 buildings, just to give you an idea, for our court use, we try to break them out into categories. What are these buildings for? Law enforcement has 9 buildings. Parks Department has 6. Emergency services, 4.
Human service buildings, what we qualify as human services, has 10, and general government, buildings are 10. So I think maybe 2-3 years ago, we went through with the facilities department and assigned letter grades to each building. This kind of helps us think about how healthy is this building? Is it an A building or a B building? So we assigned A, B, C, and D. We didn't have any buildings that we thought were Fs. We probably have one that I'm going to talk about tonight that I would consider an F at this point. So you can, out of our 40 buildings, 10 we consider A and 16s are Bs. That's not bad. That's 26 of our 40 buildings are either an A or B. B buildings have some issues, but nothing that would prevent us from using them. C and D buildings are where our real area of concern are, and they make up 14 of our 40 buildings. For all 40 buildings, we have estimated $5.4 million is the dollar amount we need to spend in capital for scattered among all 40 buildings, right? Of that $5.4 million, the capital dollar needed for C and D buildings is $3.8 million. These are known capital needs. These are problems that we know of right now today that we have as an issue. Yes.
Over what time period?
This is we have a CIP of 5 years.
Okay.
So like this year for the 17-18 budget, we only budgeted $250,000 for our own capital. So you know, we look at right now we're kind of moving on a $250,000 a year.
But the real need over 5 years is $5.4 million.
Yes, most of our needs currently fall into unassigned years. So we have a 5-year capital plan, $250,000. A great number of our needs are down in unassigned. So usually what we do, we'll work through our $250,000 worth this year. Unless something breaks that's a bigger priority than what's on the list for Buddy's crew this year, we'll work through our list. If we continue at $250,000, we'll probably never address most of the needs.
Behind.
Yes.
We are.
So you can see that 72% of the capital need is in C and D buildings. So just to give you, I'm not going to go through every one of these buildings, but just to give you an idea, these are a list of the A and B buildings, the ones that county staff have gone through and feel like, okay, these are pretty good buildings. Those A buildings are in really good shape. I will say the parks office, the park admin office this year is slated to get a new roof and boiler. That will make it an A building. It will be an A building. So you can see the list of B buildings there. So we start getting into some of our buildings that we have some more issues with. Now, it's important to know these are what we qualify as C and D, and this is a staff level estimation of the quality of these buildings. This is not like a professional level estimation, although I will say you'd be hard pressed to find anybody who knows the buildings better than Buddy, and so we have a pretty good idea. But the C buildings, we have two of our C level buildings that are vacant. Rudd Street, which is down near the EMS base on Rudd Street back behind the Human Service Center, and the Canodal property that was donated to the county, I think, two plus years ago. And also, we have our list of D buildings. We have what we consider 5 D buildings. South Annex, which was the former clinic down near Snow Camp, that was donated to the county a number of years ago. The training center that I'm going to talk about here in a little bit, it is currently vacant. Elderly Services Building, this is over behind Environmental Health, and it has two tenants. We've gone from 3 to 2, but it is needs some serious work. The Woody Drive Peak Building, which I'll talk about in just a moment, it is vacant, and Environmental Health is in pretty bad shape. So the County Manager's Office has set a facility plan as a performance management goal for this fiscal year. This is one of the things that we feel like ties into our strategic plan under the accountability and transparency pillar. We think it's important that we need a plan for our properties. Why would we want a plan? Well, we currently have 4 buildings that are sitting vacant right now. 2 of those are very large. They're 30,000 square feet. They're pretty good sized buildings. Similar in size to county office buildings, like having 2 empty county office buildings sitting out here that we're trying to figure out what to do with. Those C and D buildings I talked to you about, they have $3.8 million worth of repair needs. Well, we've been really reluctant to make repairs to those buildings because we didn't know if it's ones that we want to keep, we want to look at doing something different with or getting rid of. We do a plan, and if any C and D buildings make it through the plan, we know, okay, it is worthwhile to put money into those buildings. We want to be able to plan for counties, our future facility needs and locations. You know, if you think about county government, we've got 2 campuses, downtown Graham and East Burlington. So we're going to try to think during this planning process, if we were to, does that make sense to have two campuses? If we were going to develop anything else, where would that possibly go? Guidance for new repair needs. So as those C&D buildings start having more and more problems, if they're on the list, we'll consider fixing them. If they're not on the plan list, we wouldn't fix them. As well as building acquisitions, now you guys, the commissioners are aware that we often have people come to the county wanting to donate a property. If we have a plan and the proposed donation isn't in our plan, we wouldn't want to take that property. So it's wise to have a plan of some kind. We also want to use this plan process to clarify what organizations Alamance County will house. You know, we house county government. We also house a number of nonprofits. We also house a lot of state government. And state government, it's hard for us to plan for how we house state government because they don't come here to ask you to grow. They grow based on what Raleigh tells them. So we'll get a notice from them saying, I need 8 additional offices because the state of North Carolina has decided it's time for them to grow. So we want to make sure we're all on the same page. Who do we house in our buildings? And we have a little over $3.6 million left from the sale of the Peak Main Street property, you know, the deal we did where we sold the Woody Drive property and the North Main Street property. It was for $3.9 million. We had to spend $250,000 of that to just make the move to get everybody out of College Street. We had to do some work at Court Services and some other buildings. So we have $3.6 million left from that sale. That is fund balance. We'll make sure that's very clear to the board. That money is in fund balance and is part of our 22% calculation. But it's designated right now for possible building needs. If we want to use it or do anything with it, we need to make a decision. Do we leave it designated or do we not? A plan will help us think about that. We did begin planning work in 2015 after the sale of the North Main Street site. So once, you know, the North Main Street site, I'm talking about the Graham Manor property, once we sold the Graham Manor property, that had kind of been the thought process that that might be where county government might do something one day. Once that was sold, we had to start thinking a little bit more about what else might we do. So we have some planning efforts in hand already. But really, the pressing capital needs that the C&D buildings have and these four vacant buildings that we have that are fairly large, they've kind of put us at a point where we need to make a plan. We need to have some kind of solution. So tonight, I'm going to make a slide here at the very end where I'll make some recommendations to you. But as we've been talking about what to do about our buildings, we kind of feel like that these two first steps seem to make sense very early on in our process. We need to address two of our vacant D-rated buildings. That would be the Woody Drive Peak building that's over off the interstate in Grant, and what we have titled the HSC Training Center. Talk quickly about the HSC Training Center first. The building's located on Grand Hopedale Road. You're familiar with the Human Service Center at Old County Hospital. This building is a 2,000 square foot building that sits on Grand Hopedale Road almost directly across from the Coronado Clinic. It's in front of the building there. You may not notice it, but it's 1,900 square feet. Right now, we have estimated that building needs $146,000 in capital needs. We have shuttered that building for at least 2 years. It may have been longer than that, but it is so rife with mold, the dangerous kind of mold that we can't put people in the building. It also needs asbestos remediation, some significant repairs. We haven't been using it for a couple of years. It's time to make a decision about what to do with it. Our estimates are it'll run about $28,000 to demolish the building. That's what I would suggest that we do to this point.
Brian, could you explain where that building is again?
Yes.
I'm not sure if I thought this was the building behind the hospital that used to be the cancer center.
No, that's another one of our vacant buildings, but this one, if you look at the map here, I know we didn't really have a good aerial. So there's Graham Hopedale Road and Vaughan Road, the intersection.
Which way is north?
So this is Graham Hopedale Road going north. Okay. This is north. Here's Vaughan Road coming in. This is the Cronodle building.
Uh-huh.
This is East Lawn Elementary and right. McKinney Street. So right here under these trees is the Human Service Training Center. So there's a parking lot there on the corner of McKinney and Graham Hopedale Road. A lot of times we'll use it when we're going for meetings over at Human Service Center. So this building sits right here. It's under the trees. It's not a tree.
Was Fire Marshal in there at one time?
We had computers set up in this building. And we did training for county employees in there. You could go in, there was a bank of computers, you did training. I'm not sure what it was before that. It's been a couple of years since it's been used for anything. again, this just gives you an idea. I don't have a closer view of it. Does that help you?
Yes.
Okay. So the second building that I'm going to make a recommendation for here in just a moment is the building over off of Woody Drive, the Peak Resources building. There's the address, 779 Woody Drive. This is right there beside the hotel off of Highway 54. 32,000 plus square feet. The county acquired this building as part of a $3.9 million sale I was talking about, where we sold that property and the Graham Manor, North Main Street property, and we wound up getting the ownership of this property back, given back to the county. This was a former assisted living facility, it's a Peak Resources, that's now located on North Graham Hopedale Road. So back in February of 2015, we had the building that is still at 779 Woody Drive reviewed by firm R&D Associates, Rouse, Nicholson, and DeLuca. We had them look at this in February 2015 to give us an idea of, you know, what could this building really be used for? What was its actual condition? Their recommendation at the time was it could be used as short-term space for staff relocations. You know, at that time, we were trying to figure out what to do with the folks from College Street. We had several nonprofits we were looking at possibly having to relocate. R&D said for short-term use, this might be a good place, but major renovations would not be cost-effective. This was in the opinion of the architect and engineer. The long-term capital needs, according to R&D's report and from what we have seen over the past couple of months, the building would need significant electrical work, roof replacement, we need mechanical work, we have some significant plumbing issues, and the exterior skin of the building is almost all window. Because these were the windows in the rooms for the residents, all that would have to be replaced. So it would need some significant work, serious investment to actually make long-term use of it. The county's been operating this building as of April 2017. It's been vacant. We've kept it vacant. We're averaging $3,500 a month in power and water and gas over there, and that's empty. We have, at this time, cut off all the utilities, I believe, to the building.
We're getting ready to shut all the utilities off. The water is shut off now to the building because of the leaks.
Yes. The water leaks are pretty significant, so we've cut that off already. So we're shutting down all the utilities. So we had a recent appraisal done for the building and for the property. The property came in at $95,000 per acre as a vacant lot. Okay. So, and I'm going to show you a survey and go over that information in a little bit. We currently have an offer in hand to purchase the property as is for $100,000. Talk to you a little bit about that too. And we estimate demolition costs. This includes abatement for asbestos that may be on the property. We're not 100% sure. We believe demolition today would cost approximately $150,000. So here is a recent survey of the property. So I-85-40 is up here. This is the property. It's 6.31 acres. We did have a piece surveyed out. The county attorney, Mr. Albright, has worked with property owners back for some time, and this is a sign. This is a billboard sign that's on 8540 that we receive revenue from every month. So Mr. Albright has worked to have this piece surveyed out of the rest of the property. The county is going to retain the ownership of just this piece. So that does take the total property acreage down to 6.31 acres. And what you see here is a floor plan of the building that's there now. And this was assisted living, so you've got four different hallways. These rooms are all rooms where residents lived. Each one, if not all of them, almost all of them, have their own restroom, windows. It would be a little difficult to convert this over to office space use. It would take some, besides the work that needs to be done to the building in general for its operating systems, it would really be an effort to convert this over to offices. So, but this gives you an idea of how the building lays out. Oops. So at this time, we do not have any county use planned or foreseen for this building or for this property. We have, since the county has become owner of the property, we have met with some nonprofits. We have talked to some folks about some possible use. There have been some very worthy ideas floated. I think the issue has always been the funding needed to update this building to make it really last from where it is now. So the nonprofits we've talked to have some good ideas. I think it would be difficult for them to come up with funding, and it would be very difficult for the county to come up with funding to fix it and then turn it over to a nonprofit. Utilities have been and are being disconnected due to cost. And what I would suggest to the board is that the county is going to hold this property for the long term, perhaps to wait for a market or a good price. The best way to do that is without the building. Right now, with the building there, even vacant, does make it a little bit difficult for us to just hold it indefinitely to wait for a good offer.
Let me ask you something.
Yes, sir.
Clyde, when you talked to us back at that time, you said, you said that they were going to tear it down at their expense.
That's correct. That was the original deal.
What happened to that?
The manager took a look at it. We realized when we tore it down, when they tore down the Sammy Epps building,
yeah,
we'd have to have a place for the veterans, folks, planning, for building inspections,
uh-huh,
for mapping, and there was one other thing there. But anyway, he had the architect go over to take a look at the Peak building. They had just put $300,000 in the air conditioning and roof over there at Peak. And the analysis of that was that it would be 3 to 5 year life on that building. So we made the determination it would be a good swing space for county employees to park people and maybe some nonprofits.
How many people were involved? I asked Brian this. How many people were involved in the supposed transfer movement? 20 people?
I don't know.
Yeah. That was done after we left, I think,
yeah,
and I'm not saying it would have been stopped, but I can't comprehend that the decision was made to keep that building without an approval of the board.
I cannot imagine.
Now, I was told that the reason that they did it was in the paperwork that the county manager, which was not Brian, it was Mr. Honeycutt, was able to carry out the transactions of the deal.
Yeah.
Now, to me, simple paperwork versus a major decision of keeping that is not a good business decision,
no,
in my opinion. I can't
business.
Comprehend that.
I cannot either.
That we gave up a chance for them to tear it down. And as far as I can tell, there was no monetary consideration. I've asked this question: if it's going to take $150,000 to tear it down, it would have cost them $150,000. You assume. Why didn't they give us another $100,000? Because they weren't going to have to tear it down.
Well, the deal changed. I believe Mr. Manning did some present value analysis of that. And I'll have to go back and look at his paperwork, but he gave a report to the board where that might increase the money to us. We got a lump sum payment.
Yeah.
We were going to get paid over a period of time. We were going to lease the building. We were going to give it back to them. It was a complex transaction because we had to transfer the building to Peak so he could transfer the beds. And then Peak was going to give us the building back. The original deal was he was going to tear the existing structure down and then give us the land back. But with these other changes that came up, the manager came to see me right after the report from the architect and said we need to change this contract.
But the board was not addressed, as far as you know.
Well, I don't know. I don't know what conversations the manager had with the board chairs. Mr. Smith was the board chair at the time.
Oh, Smith was? Okay, Smith was chair. But Honeycutt was the manager, right?
That's correct.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yes. It's 2014, I believe.
Well, paying for it now.
Yep. Yeah. That was a bad call. I don't know who done that, but that was a bad call.
So we have been made aware there may be some grant funding that would help offset the cost of the demolition. This has come in very, very new. It's possible there would be some grant funding if you take county-owned, government-owned property that you're going to return to commercial use, put back on the private market. We're going to look into that and see if that might be something that we could pursue to help offset that $150,000 cost. Also, we've had discussions with the Fire Marshal's Office, Grand Fire Department, about the possibility of their being able to do some fire training at the building that may help. One, it would help the fire departments. I think there's been some interest from the state in doing some arson training. They don't get this opportunity very often, and it also may help us offset demo costs. So we're going to be looking into those things, and I'm going to make a recommendation to you specific here in just a moment. So if you need any of this information, I'll go back over it. But I've kind of reached the end of the peak information. The second step that I'd like to talk about tonight. So it's tied to the Peak property deal. When we sold the North Main Street property, we had the departments that Mr. Sutton was talking about in the building there on College Street that was later torn down. Planning and inspections were the two major departments there. They were relocated from the College Street, North Main Street property to a modular building over on Grand Hopedale Road. Sits right there beside the PAYC, right there near Blue Modular. This was a temporary move that has turned into a couple of years now. It wasn't the long-term solution, but it's kind of turned into that now. We have some staff space issues. Those folks are pretty packed into that building. And it has created parking issues at Grand Hopedale Road. We brought planning and inspections employees, their fleet, their visitors, on top of the Ag Department has, you know, y'all know they have numerous programs throughout the week where they bring master gardeners and large groups in for the Ag building. So we've had to kind of juggle how do we park people over there. So in the meantime, just recently, we've had a significant amount of space open up at the Court Services Building, which is a building located diagonally from the county office building here on Elm Street. We had a nonprofit that took up half of that building, has gone away. They're down to one person, so we've relocated that one person. So a good significant chunk of the Court Services Building has opened up. Planning and inspections have looked at this space. Believe it would be feasible for them to be relocated over to the Court Services Building. We have costs for that relocation. We would be taking that out of the maintenance budget. We do not have a firm idea of what that may be. We don't think it would be dramatic changes to the building, but anytime you move 20 employees, there's going to be some costs. But we don't need any money from anywhere else. We have that in the maintenance budget now. It would also allow us, if what we would talk with ACTA about doing. ACTA is one of the tenants that's in the Elderly Services Building. This is one of our D buildings, one of our poor shaped buildings. We would move ACTA, if it would work, and I believe it would, from Elderly Services into the modular building. They're still on the same site, just around the corner. They would be able to park their vehicles just as they do now, but it would be better space than what they have. So this is a summary of the action that I would like to suggest for the board to consider. I'd like for you to consider approving up to $28,000 for the demolition of the HSC training center. This is the one over on Grand Hotel Road. Those funds would come from the designated funds from the sale of Woody Drive. We have $3.6 million left right now. This is fund balance. It is fund balance. I want to make sure that's clear. But I would suggest that we take $28,000 out and tear that building down. I would suggest that the board reject the offer by B&W Trailer. We have an offer in hand right now for $100,000 to purchase the Peak Woody Drive site. I would suggest that you vote to reject that offer. I'd also suggest that you allow us to post the Woody Drive property for sale for the next 90 days for $489,450. This is the appraised value of the property with the building standing. So it's $95,000 an acre. The appraiser suggested that we take $110,000 off of that because the building is there. So that would be a fair consideration. Put the property up for sale for $489,450 tomorrow. Let it run for 90 days. In those 90 days, we will look into this grant that I just talked to you about. But could that possibly be used for demo? We'll work with the fire marshal's office to see how feasible it really would be to do some controlled burns in this building to lessen the cost. We would also be looking at putting out bids for the demo. We'd be doing all these things in the background while the building's sitting there for 90 days for sale. If the building does not sell in 90 days, I will come back to the board, tell you it has not sold, request then that you approve up to $150,000 from those same funds. At that time, we would demolish the building, and then I would suggest you put the building up for sale for $599,450. That is the appraised value with the building gone. And at that point, commissioners, we can sit on this property as long as you care to. As long as the building's gone, we're just mowing the property. You may get a price that comes in sometime less than $599,000. You don't want to sell. The building's gone. We can reject that offer and just wait for as long as you would like. I'm also asking not for approval. It doesn't technically take approval, but I would like to make sure there is a consensus from the board about the relocation of planning and inspections from Grand Hopedale Road to the Court Services Building here in Graves. This time, if you need me to go back over any of these slides, I'd be happy to. If you have any questions, I'll certainly try to answer those too.
Are you again, I might have missed this, but are you saying that with the building gone, it only appraised for how much?
$599,450.
Appraisal, a million or millions, how many acres is it?
It's 6.31 acres after we've surveyed out the sign, which the sign was maybe half an acre, I believe, about half.
Yes.
I thought we had an appraisal much higher than that with just the lot of the land.
This one, we just had this appraisal done very recently. I've got it with me tonight, but I don't have the date. But I mean, this was within.
In April, I believe.
You would think with the.
I think we got the results back in.
The visibility that it has, it would go for a premium price. Yeah.
Well, what I would say, if you feel like the appraisal price is too low.
Take that.
No, that's
right. Absolutely not. If you feel, now you don't have to put it up for sale for 90 days at that price. I was suggesting that because in that interim, it'll take us that long to get everything together to demo. But if you don't want to put it up for sale and you want us to just go ahead and go through the procedure of getting it ready to demolish, you could approve tonight the $150,000, we'll demo it, and then you sit on it as long as you want to. My only concern is I don't want the county to sit on it for a very long time with just the vacant building there, because it is continuing to go.
I'd rather keep the property without the building.
Yeah, exactly. Right.
That's exactly right.
And then we'll have other offers or other opportunities for sale.
And that nothing say you didn't put it out there for $599.
Yeah, you don't have to put it out there with a price, I wouldn't think. You can just let it be known you're interested in taking offers on the property.
How many acres is the hotel lot? Do you know? Do we have any idea?
I do not. I'm sorry. But it's similar, yes.
Yeah. You already have a buyer.
It'd be nice for that to be tax-generating property.
It'd be hard for me to believe if another hotel came in and wanted to put a hotel right beside that other hotel, which they do all the time.
Right.
But they wouldn't think that property is worth more than $500,000.
Yeah, I think you're right, Tim.
Well, the city of Graham had sent us a letter back some time ago encouraging us to put it back on the tax rolls. So they would be interested in that. I think they were very pleased with the Peak Resources property that was built on Graham Hotel Road. That was several millions dollars, maybe upwards of 10, I don't remember. Mm-hmm. So that's an option for you to consider. Try to sell it right now with the building on it. You avoid the up to possibly $150,000 demo cost. Someone may buy it, but you're also taking the risk that it may sell for much less than you could get if it were gone and we were just patient. That could be a reasonable move too. If you go the patient waiting mode, I would suggest that you approve tonight using up to $150,000. We'll go ahead and start the motions to demo it. We won't list it at all until it's demolished.
Okay, let me make sure I understand something. If you offer it for $599,450, 90 days. If somebody comes along with $599,450, we'd have to take it, right?
No.
Why not?
It's always up to us.
The statute provides
that's dirty pool. No, I want to keep the land myself with the building gone.
Yeah, I agree with you.
Yeah, that's where you're going
to
make your money.
We need to tear that down, keep the land.
I think so, yeah. I mean, you're giving the property away $400,000.
We don't want to give it away.
You're just simply giving it away.
The only thing you're avoiding is the demo cost at that point.
Yeah, that's fine. Yeah. I'll support the demo cost, but I won't keep the lot for now.
For now, yeah.
So is what I'm hearing then that sounds like the board is interested in the $28,000 for the demo of the training center and $150,000 for the demo of Woody Drive.
That makes sense.
We can revisit when you want to put it up for sale, but we'll demolish it.
Once the property's clean, it's easier for a buyer to say,
right.
We want to move now, which a lot of them like to move quickly. Mm-hmm.
So you would also be in favor of rejecting the offer to purchase for
$100,000? Yes. I think I would give it.
I don't know that I would even told us about it.
Well, we must.
Well, he had it, so he had to.
Yeah. That's laughable.
Well, I'd be willing to make the motion, just to make sure I reflect what you all want, that we start the motions of demolishing the building and not list it for sale at this time.
Until it's demolished.
Until after it's demolished and we can revisit it.
Yeah.
And then we reject the $100,000 offer.
Yes.
Is that all we need for?
Oh, are you?
And the HSC.
HSC training.
Well, I'll include that.
Both properties.
I'll include that in my motion too, to demolish that. And if it's appropriate, I'll go ahead and include the moving of the folks that are in the blue trailer over to the court services building.
And we are approving the up to $150,000 from the designated funds for demolishing.
For the demolishing, yes.
On the Woody Drive property, and then the $28,000 for the HSC.
Yes, thank you. That's included in my motion.
So that affects your headache now, right? If they're gone.
Yeah.
I know this is after fact, but what's to the, let's see, the other side of the lot? In other words, you got the hotel on one side, you got the rest home in the middle. What's on that far side? It's an industry, isn't it?
It's the trailer.
That's the gentleman.
SCI building, or what used to be another building.
That's correct. Yes.
That's a great location.
He wants that lot because it's there on the road.
That's a great location.
Mm-hmm, that's nice.
Pays fair price, he can get it.
That's right.
So Commissioner, I want to make sure I'm very clear on this too, because I know this was a lot of action. You're voting on demolishing the Woody Drive Peak building and using up to $150,000 of designated funds to do so, to reject the $100,000 offer from the trailer folks for the Woody Drive property. You're voting to approve $28,000 from the designated funds from the sale of the Main Street and Woody Drive properties to demolish HSC Training Center. And you're also voting to move planning and inspections to court services.
Yes.
Okay.
That's my motion.
Thank you.
That's your motion.
Okay.
I'll second that.
I've already seconded it.
You didn't done it? Okay, we're good. You passed me. All right. We got a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
There you go. We did what the county manager recommended there. County manager report.
Oh, well, I have one item for your consideration. So we have the World Trade Center Memorial. Just give you an update and also get your thoughts. The World Trade Center Memorial, it toured. It went around the county. It visited several law enforcement agencies, fire departments, stayed for a while at EMS, stayed for a while at CECOM. Well received everywhere. It was very moving to go out and meet with these folks, and everybody appreciated the opportunity for it to come and visit their specific department. Currently, it is in the lobby at the county office building right downstairs. Now, back when we developed the memorial, we talked about different places the World Trade Center Memorial could go. We offered a vote out to the general public to give us some ideas. Two top places were county office building and the historic courthouse. Only three votes separated those two. I will tell you that it has been well received here at the county office building. I would suggest that the board consider allowing us to leave it here. We've talked about both places. We've talked about the historic courthouse. To me, this seems like a good place. If you agree, we can leave it here. I don't think this necessarily needs a vote, but if there's a consensus, we will go ahead and start getting some signage, some nice signs that explain the monument, where it came from, what it's about. And then on September 11th of this year, we'll have a little ceremony for it there in the county office building. So, and it can be relocated if it needs to. We can take it up to the historic.
Very good.
Is that acceptable
to
the board?
Yep.
Okay. Great. That's all I have.
All right. Any commissioner comments?
I'd like to say something. I see that we have Rick Rutan in our audience tonight from Cardinal Innovations Healthcare. He's the executive for the five-county area, which includes Alamance, Caswell, Orange, Person, and Chatham counties. And as you know that when Cardinal Healthcare Innovations became the managed care organization and local management entity for mental health in our area, it was really for Alamance and Caswell counties, and then they were also were the MCO LME for the Orange, Person, Chatham counties as well. Well, in the Cardinal system, they really try to consolidate more. Well, let me back up. In each one of these areas, there's a community operations board. It's more of an advisory board, but each COB has an appointed county commissioner on it, and it's to sort of hold, to make sure there's good communication between the community and Cardinal Innovations. And and sort of hold them accountable to make sure that, you know, we're being served appropriately, and it's in addition to the, just enhancing communications. Well, we, the two boards, the Community Operations Board from Orange Person County and the board from Alamance Caswell, at the suggestion of the hierarchy of Cardinal Innovations, decided that we would consolidate our boards, and I wanted to let this board know that that's happened, and we're doing it on a one-year trial basis. And I think that the main, if there's a concern, is the concern would be to make sure that we're not watering down the amount of accountability or the amount of input that we have as Alamance County into the mental health services that are being provided here. We've had two meetings as a combined board, and frankly, I think that it's actually probably better because we have more counties involved to see what each other's doing, to see how services are being provided, to see how the maintenance of effort funding is being spent, because each of us are doing it a little bit different way. But to me, it's helpful to having those other four commissioners in the room and they're receiving their ideas about quality of services and comparing notes, and they provide good comparative data that we can benchmark off of each other. So we're trying this for a year, and I just want to let you know to see if you have any comments about that. And after a year...
Let me ask, why is that legal? What they're doing, is that legal? I don't think it is.
Well,
they don't have that choice to make decisions.
I haven't looked at that
for
some time.
This county.
Well, we were already in a combined county with Caswell.
Not Orange County. I don't think that's a good deal.
I can check.
That's not a good deal for Alamance County.
So I think what it comes down to is what the legal basis or what the legal requirement is to have for having a community operations board to begin with. And Rick, maybe you can comment.
Statutorily, there's supposed to be a board of directors, and we have maintained the local boards just to get that local input, as you said, and to give some more oversight of what we're doing locally.
But that board of directors you're talking about is the governing body of...
Correct. I believe that's what you see. It's put in there, and that's the board of directors. That's what we're statutory.
So that's the governing body. So we're not really a governing body. We're an advisory... Kind of an advisory group.
Correct.
And we still have the same representatives from Alamance County. So we have the CFAC, the Community
Consumer,
and Family...
Consumer and Family Advisory.
Consumer and Family Advisory Council. The same representation there. Same commissioner. We're all just meeting together, essentially, what it is.
Yes.
And all the data that... they're giving us about the services that are being provided is county specific. It's not all rolled up in one.
Yeah, my intent is to give as much local data to every one of those five counties as possible, so you can get insight in what's going on in your county.
I don't think it's legal.
I'll get an answer.
Check on that.
All right, thank you.
Very good. All right, any other comments?
I'm going to maybe act out of line a little bit, a little nosy, but you three or four there, are you in? Yes.
I'll be glad to.
Please, I'm just curious as to what they saw fit in coming here tonight. And they're welcome.
Well, this is a hot ticket, actually.
Yeah.
So what you have in front of you, are our 2017-2018 Elon Alamance Health Partners, which is a postgraduate fellow program that the health department, the hospital, and Elon University have as a partnership together. And so each one of these ladies, and there's also one other person who's not with us today, Elise, who are placed in one of the health service agencies in our county, one for the health department, one for the hospital, one for Impact Alamance, and one for Healthy Alamance. And I'll let them introduce themselves to you.
My name's Chloe Donahoe, and I'm working at the health department with Stacy.
My name is Marion Hayward, and I work at Alamance Regional.
I'm Vashti Shimamala, and I'm at Impact Alamance.
We're glad y'all are here.
Thank y'all for coming. All right, no more comments. At this time, I would like to move that we now go into closed session pursuant to North Carolina General Statute, Section 143-318-11A3, in order to preserve the attorney-client privilege between the county attorney and the board, and receive a report regarding claims made in the cases in Manning versus Alamance County and Randleman versus Alamance County Sheriff. And I ask for a second on
second.
That, please. Thank you, Bill. All in favor?
Aye.
All right, we will go into closed session.
Yeah.
All right, I'd like to make a motion that we go back into open session and
I'll second that.
All right, thank you, Bill. All in favor?
Aye.
What we did is gave the county attorney directions on the settlement or working on these two cases, and that's all we have to report tonight. And we have no other business. I move that we adjourn.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers at the County Office Building at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month is at 9 a.m. and the second meeting of the month is at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. The video of this meeting is broadcast on Time Warner's public access channel on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month at 10 p.m. You can also access this meeting through our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information about watching meetings online. For technical questions regarding this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions regarding the content of commissioners' meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says County Commissioners to learn more about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about the County Commissioners. You can send mail correspondence to the commissioners by sending it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.